Because he lives. It's Easter Sunday.
We are celebrating the fact that Jesus Christ lives. What's up, y'all? My name is Pastor Joy.
I'm Larry Brown Jr. Welcome to Zion Anywhere, the online campus of Zion Church. We're so happy to have you today. As you know, we love to check in with you at the top of server to see where your anywhere is. So go ahead and drop that in the chat now to let us know where you're watching service from.
That's right. As you're answering, want you all to also notice that we are rocking some new Zion Church gear.
Indeed.
Gear that you can have if you go to zmch.org/gear. You can get your own shirt. Throughout Zion Church today, we are celebrating the miraculous truth that Jesus Christ is alive, that our Lord and Savior died, was buried, and resurrected with all power in his hand, and what that means to us. So, Larry, your shirt says, because he lives, I am free. Tell us more.
Listen, whom the sun sets free is truly free indeed, Pastor Joy. And every day, freedom is a gift that is given to me, and it's a choice that I make to embrace 10 toes down so that I can show up in the world and be who God has created me to be without reservation and attack everything with reckless abandon and say, I am here, I'm me, and I'm free because God made me free.
Amen, amen. For me, I am celebrating the truth that because he lives, I am loved. That the Bible says that while we were still sinners, Christ demonstrated, he showed his love for us by dying for us. And so I don't have to seek love. I don't have to earn love. It's already mine in Christ Jesus. So you let us know what's your because he lives truth. Maybe you resonate with the fact that because he lives, you're free, that you're loved, that you're enough, that you're redeemed, that you're restored, that you're whole. We want to know. Let us know in chat where you're joining us from and complete the statement, because he lives, I am ... I am so happy. You know, one of the things that I love about Resurrection Sunday is just how many people are with us, how many people come to church, how many people come to like celebrate, how many people come with family.
Yes.
I'm hoping we can have some of those people join us today.
We have some people here today that are standing by. They are ready. Oh, come on. Good morning. Welcome. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Happy Easter.
Same to you.
You are most welcome. Welcome. Come on and join us. The family is here. I love it. And y'all are fit dressed for the occasion. We're so happy to have you.
Thank you.
Tell us your names and where you're from.
Hey, and use mine so that way we can hear you better.
Yes, here we go. I got you.
Uh-oh. My name is Benita Stainrod. I live in Fort Washington.
Fantastic.
My name is Tarsa Scott, and I'm from Fort Washington, Maryland.
Awesome. Okay, so today, all throughout Zion Church, we're celebrating the truth that because he lives and what that means for us. So when you think of the statement, because he lives, I am blank, how would you fill in the blank?
Because he lives, I am healed. I am free from all bondages and trauma that I've been through in life. God has afforded me to be able to overcome a lot of obstacles, which then allows me to be able to show my light to others and let others be free too.
Okay, nice.
And how about you?
I live because he lives. And the reason I live is because he carried me through a lot. And I'm blessed to be here.
That's beautiful.
I love it. Now, do you all have any favorite Easter memories or traditions that you want to share?
My favorite Easter tradition is with my mom. Back in the day, going to the monument, the White House, where you didn't have to get a ticket. Uh-huh. You could just go to the Easter egg hunt if you're there. Those are my favorite memories for Easter.
And for me, just thinking back, because my mom is no longer here, but just thinking back to her getting us ready for church and pressing our hair on Sunday mornings and putting on the beautiful Easter dresses, but also, you know, just giving us the foundation of God's word and why we're here and, you know, his resurrection. So that was our yearly or Easter memories.
Awesome. All right. Now, before we let you go, are there any special shout outs you want to give to anyone who may be watching us today?
Just to all my family and friends. We do have a lot of family and friends that watch and come here. So I just want to bless my family and ask God to continue to cover us and heal us and my clients and friends too.
Awesome.
Same thing as well to my family and friends. And this is my niece, so we live together. And just happy Easter to everyone.
Yes.
Y'all have a wonderful family time together at service and after service and for the rest of this season. Thank y'all for stopping by.
Thank you.
Thank y'all.
Yeah. That was beautiful.
That was
so beautiful. That was so beautiful. I'm often reminded of the different traditions that we share as families and individuals. I think about my family who lives in a different state right now, but all the memories that we created from going to 6 o'clock service, 7:30 service, 11 o'clock service, and doing all the church things for Easter,
all
and then having
the
to take
things.
Off the suit and run around and do all the things with my cousin. So it's a wonderful time. It's a wonderful time.
And what
time.
I love about celebrating the life and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is that it's not just a one Sunday thing, right? Yeah. So we have these traditions and we have these memories, but the Bible actually tells us that every time we take communion, we remember Christ's sacrifice.
Right.
So we don't have to wait to Resurrection Sunday or to spring. Every time that we take communion together mm-hmm. is another opportunity to remember. And so I'm grateful that today all of us at Zion Church across all of our campuses are partaking in communion.
We are. We invite you to get your elements ready and prepare them for communion. It can be a simple cracker or a piece of bread and a cup of juice, whatever it may be. Go ahead and grab it now so you have your elements ready for communion.
All right. And as a reminder, if this is your first time joining us, want to let you know that you matter to us. And we want to stay connected with you. So if you text ZAVIP to 51555, that gives us the opportunity to get to know you, whether it's your first time, your 100th time, mm-hmm. your fifth time, or your 50th time. We are always looking for ways to connect with you, to pray with you, to help you get connected to life groups or serving opportunities. And the best way to do that is by texting ZAVIP to 51555.
And if this is your first time joining us, logging on to Zion Church Anywhere, welcome. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We are so very happy that you joined us today. And we hope that you come back again.
We do. And please note that we have chat hosts on our church online platform, Facebook and YouTube. This Sunday, we have our team called SWAG, Save with Amazing Grace, led by Coach Brandy Becton. They are there for you again to enhance your viewing experience.
SWAG, Save with Amazing Grace. I absolutely love that. I love a good acronym. Anytime, any day. Listen, we invite you also to share the service with someone, then subscribe and comment and like the video on YouTube.
Well, let's see what y'all are saying in the chat. Let's see who's joining us. We have God's Woman from Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania.
Uh-huh.
Who else we got?
We have Rowena Dodson from Danbury, Connecticut.
That's right. And Evelyn Renee in Richmond, Virginia says, because I am live. She says she's free.
Hey, sis, we free together. We are free together.
And Candace McIntyre says, because he lives, I am forgiven of mm-hmm. my sins.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord, for yes. forgiveness. Yes. Keep letting us know in chat your statement. Because he lives, what? What does that mean to you? How is your life changed by the truth that Jesus Christ lives? As we prepare to go into service, again, we want to remind you that this day, while it's great about eggs and bunnies and dressing up, that the real reason is Jesus. It's yeah. because we celebrate, because we serve a resurrected Savior. Matthew 25 verse 5 says, then the angel spoke to the woman. Don't be afraid, he said. I know you were looking for Jesus who was crucified. Verse 6 says, he isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said he would come and see where his body was lying. I hope this is a reminder to you that God keeps his word, that Jesus keeps his word, that Jesus truly is a way maker, promise keeper. Know that whatever God has spoken to you, just like he said that he would raise from the dead, Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and he is faithful to keep his word.
Absolutely. Be sure to stay logged in after the message so we can share our takeaways after service today. Pastor Joy, we want to pray. Are we going to go into service?
Yes.
All right.
Dear God, we're so grateful that Jesus lives. We're so
yes.
grateful for what that means. We're grateful that we're free, that we're
thank
loved,
you, Lord.
That we're forgiven, that we're whole, and that we can be connected to you in eternity.
Yes.
Thank you for this opportunity to praise you. As we lift up our voices, be pleased with our worship. Be pleased with our praise. In Jesus' name,
amen. Amen. All right, Pastor Joy. We'll see y'all after service.
Bye, y'all.
Okay, let's usher march. Come on. I'm going to put one hand behind my back. Right. Uh-huh.
Whoa. Church, Zion Green Bay, we serve a risen Savior. Can somebody say hallelujah in the room? Hallelujah in the room. He is risen just as he said. Come on. Hallelujah. Great, where are you now? You've been overpowered. Death, where is your sting? Conquered by the King. Resurrected one.
Resurrected one.
Hey, shining like the sun.
Shining like the sun.
Breaking through the fear. Oh, victory. Victory is here now.
Oh, hallelujah.
Say, Jesus. We serve a risen Savior, y'all. Everybody say he's risen. Forever. I'm so glad that he's risen. King Jesus. Say hallelujah. Zion anywhere. Zion Green Bay. Come on, make some noise. Say. Keep shining, keep shining. Hey, breaking through the fear. Oh, victory. Victory, 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 victory. Let's hear Zion. Hallelujah. Come on and say Jesus.
Does anybody know that God got the victory? He rose on the third day with all power. Y'all sing this song with me.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Can I hear y'all? Come on.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I hear y'all. Zion anywhere, sing it out. Come on.
Death could not hold you down. Oh, yeah. You are the risen.
I hear y'all.
You're seated in. You are the risen King.
Now, Zion Church, Zion Anywhere, let's make this thing a big choir. Y'all sing it to the top of your lungs. Hallelujah.
You have won.
Victory belongs to him.
Come on, say,
oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus, yeah. Victory belongs to him.
Come on, let's help him.
Sing it, come on.
That's a like me. See, I once, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Hallelujah.
Was blind, but now I see.
I didn't know about the power in your blood.
Was blind, but now
I see. And this is what I see. Because you took the scales from my eyes. You thought I was worth saving. This is what I see. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Yes, you were. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free. I could be whole. And I could tell everyone I know. So you came in. You thought I was worth. So you cleaned me. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love. If you want to know what love is, that's what love is. They hung him high, stretched him wide. He hung his head for me. That's love. Say that again. They hung him high.
They hung him high.
Stretched him wide.
He hung his head
for me. As dirty as I am, you still thought it not robbery. This is my favorite part. But that's not how the story. 3 days later, he rose again.
Story.
Three, eight, three.
like you. Father, you sit high and you look low and you love us in spite of us. There is no one that's worthy like our God. He's worth whatever it took for you to get here today. He's worth the lines you stood in. He's worth the parking lot. He's worth any praise. He's worth more praise than any house you ever bought. He's worthy of more praise than any car you've ever driven. He's worthy of more praise than ever any promotion you've ever received. There is no praise like the praise that we give to our God. He's worthy of more praise than any football team you've ever celebrated. There is no God like our God. Okay, let me try to explain it to you, because some of y'all might say, man, is it really worth all of that? Does it really take all of that to give God praise? Let me explain why he's so worthy. If I can paint a picture, I went to Disney Springs and I saw a bakery and there was a line of people waiting for a cookie, literally 1 hour just waiting to get inside. And I kept saying to myself, I said, man, there's no way that there's any cookie on earth that's worth waiting an hour just to eat. And so I saw the people and I was judging them. And then at some point I said to myself, well, if they're waiting, it might be worth it. And so I stood in line. And when I got inside, I saw people so happy. Nobody was worried about the lines. And I finally made the purchase, and I got the cookie home, and opened up the wrapper, and I took a bite of the cookie, and instantly I understood why they waited. And maybe you don't know why it's worth it, but it's something about when you taste and you see that the Lord is good, and you look back over your life and you think things over, you can't help but say to yourself, that's love. When you've tasted it for yourself, you ain't got to get no commentary from nobody else. God, that's love. Okay, let me say it to you this way. Maybe you didn't get it that way. You know, most of us assess worth based on condition and the quality. So if it's in good condition and the quality is high and there's a high demand, there's something natural in us that says we're willing to pay whatever it takes to get that. But most of us would never pay full price for something that's broken, okay? But God, who is rich in mercy, while you were still lying, while you were still laid up in the bed with him or her, or while you were still cheating on your taxes, while you were still fussing and cussing, my God says, I'm still willing to pay full price. You're worth the son, and you're worth my son, and you're worth my son, and you're worth my son, because that's love.
That's love.
In case you were wondering whether it takes all of that, I want to declare on this day that when he rose from the grave with all power, I'm telling you right now that in your worst state, God says you're still worth full price. So since God paid full price, can we take about 30 seconds to give him full praise? Because he's going to lift the roof off of this. Hey, let him know. Hey, thank you that you got me while I was still a hot mess. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, worship team. Yes. Oh, we making some noise because he's worthy. Well, it is because he's worthy that he has called us to this sacred practice called communion. You may have your seat. And the purpose of communion is to remind us of the price he paid and the power we have. It's to remind us of what? The price he paid and the power we have. And somebody says, well, what's the purpose of communion? Why are we even having it? In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26, says, whenever we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So the bread symbolizes his body, which was broken for us and served as a substitute for our sins. I'm telling you right now, Lord, Pastor, First Lady, I'm so grateful that he took my place, because I couldn't afford to pay. Y'all know how much I sin. I can't afford to pay for mine. Thank you, Lord, that you covered my sins. But then it says that the wine symbolizes a new agreement, a new covenant. Here it is that his blood canceled the record of sin. The charges that were held against you were dropped. Okay. Maybe you don't know. I don't care how good you think you are. All of us were guilty, and all of us had the same sentence, death, eternal separation from God. And because of the blood covering our sins, God says you are exonerated. You are pardoned. So thank you. So this is why we come together to practice communion. And let the church say, amen. Well, this also requires a time for us to do some examination. Scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27, so anyone who eats this bread or drinks the cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Verse 28 says, that is why you should do what? Examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. That is why many of you are weak and sick. And it goes on to say, and some have even died. But if we examine ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this way. And so I want to give you a moment right now to just say, Lord, search my heart and see if I got a beef against you or against others that before I can participate in communion, I want to reconcile. In other words, God says, don't dishonor the price I paid to cover your sins by not being able to forgive somebody of theirs. And so I want to give you space just to take a moment. Says, God, I want to clear the air. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. You know the power of confession? The power of confession isn't just for the person who hurts you. The power of confession is to free you up. Whatever you give to God, God gives you freedom in that space. And whatever you hold on, Satan uses to hold you back. And so we want to say, Lord, thank you for the opportunity to get this mess off of us. So the Lord makes it clear that communion is an ordinance to be practiced by believers. That means that if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, it is okay not to participate. In other words, don't worry about with people who sit next to you, don't worry about what they think, because you're like, man, well, I don't take it because everybody else taking it, they don't think I got a problem. Here's the news. Everybody got problems. So when God has moved your heart to place your trust in him, then you are welcome to participate. But until then, just let the cup pass, and we are trusting God for your life. He got you covered already. Amen? All right. Well, let's prepare to dive into this moment of communion in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 and 24. Before I go there, by the way, if you don't have communion elements, please raise your hand and someone will be by to give that to you. And if you're watching online, please grab your grape juice or your apple juice or your crackers. The actual elements that you're using does not disqualify you in communion. The power is in us doing this together. Amen? All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread, and he gave what? thanks to God for it. And the Bible says, then he broke it into pieces and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Thank you, Lord, for this bread. Take and eat. Thank you, Lord. And if you can get the grape juice open faster than I can, good for you. The struggle is real. All right, I got it. Thank you, boy. That's tough when you need somebody to help you open the grape juice. All right. All right. Verse 25 says, in the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup, oh, Lord, thank you, is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. Take and drink. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Say thank you, Lord. All right, I want to give you, let's do a quick corporate prayer. Hey, say, I want you to repeat after me. He says, thank you, Lord, for accepting me, for atoning for my sins, and adopting me into your family. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as we celebrate the goodness of the Lord, can you help me celebrate the sacrifice of our senior pastor for all of the work, our first lady, for what they do to make this church possible as he comes to lead us. God bless you.
Appreciate you, buddy. Well, this is a great day. This is our Super Bowl. This is our national championship. This is our World Cup title. And I'm so grateful that God let us be in church again on Resurrection Sunday. Whether you drove to a physical location or you just tuned in attentively online, it's a blessing to be here. Let me state the obvious today. Some of you, this is just like old church, because the children got to sit with you today. Amen. So it's going to be a lot of pinching and a lot of, hey, there's going to be a lot of that going on. So I'm going to hurry up and get through this. We're sorry we had to close Children's Church for this service at this location because we need the seating today. It'll be back open actually at 1:30 service today. If you want to come back and just drop your kids off and go get a break. I didn't say that. Hey, thank God for all of our pastors who did such a great job reminding us of the importance of Jesus' sacrifice today. Our amazing We Are Zion music team that reminded us of the importance of this day. It's been a great day already, and we are so grateful. This is a time in our service where we honor God through giving. And for those of you who are joining us, and our guest today, I want to tell you to not feel any obligation to give to our church. You're our guest. And the people who consider this their church home, we all pay the bills here. So we wouldn't expect you to pay bills as a guest any more than if you came over to our personal homes. We wouldn't expect you to pay the bills there. Your presence is a gift to us. So thank you for being here. For those of you who are participating in the offering today, let me share a scripture with you that I think is apropos to both today and to this moment of giving. And that is John 3:16, which says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And that is the greatest news ever given to man, that God provided salvation for us by giving us his only son. What a gift. But what I want you to also see is what inspired his giving was love. Before he gave, he loved. And watch this. The proportion of his gift was, the size of his gift was in direct proportion to the great vastness of his love. He so loved the world that he gave his only son. Now, I'm gonna be honest with you, that's level, there are levels to love. There's some things I love enough to give to. I wouldn't give any of my children, I can't think of anything I would give any of my children to. But God so loved the world that he gave his only son for us. So there are levels of love. And so what we should do when we give is be inspired to give based on love, not on legalism, not based on rules. We give because, first of all, we love God. And we love what he's done for us personally, and we love his work. So that's why we give. And you give out of love. If you, how many of you, if you buy Girl Scout cookies, do you buy the Girl Scout cookies because you love the cookies or you love the Girl Scouts? You ever thought of that? Even if you love both, it's still being driven by love. Amen. So may love drive our giving now. Hey, if you're giving, you're not giving an electronic gift, you're giving a manual gift, and you're at one of our locations, please use an envelope. Make designation on your envelope, and then pass your envelope to the left of the row you're on after I pray. If you're in Zion Church, Fort Washington, and you're sitting up front to my right, your left, please pass your gifts to your right after I pray. I'm going to pray right now. Father, thank you for this opportunity to be in church today. Thank you for this opportunity to support your work. And we pray now that these gifts that are given would exceed the needs of the mission of this local church. May it bless lives ultimately, we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody that agrees said amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, you may give at this time. And while you are giving, I want to tell you all about our inaugural leadership conference that we're having. First one we ever have. You want to be a part of this. Whatever sector you live in, lead in. If you're an aspiring leader, you're a current leader, you're a leader who hung up your leadership boots, but you're going to help somebody else along the way. We have a conference that's going to give you tools and resources and information that's going to inspire you as a leader, going to give you encouragement and your second wind if you're tired. We're excited about that. We're going to reveal to you some of our speakers. Dr. Bruce Jones is a professor and senior vice president of research at Howard University. He's going to be with us talking about leadership in the academic arena, but also how to get funding for your vision, how to get resources, because a vision without provision is a nightmare. Amen. Tessa Edison is the CEO of Asset Management Consulting. It's a branding firm. Also, she has been recently inducted into the BO Collective, which is a collective of women in business across the nation, the top 1% of women in business across the nation. She's a part of that, and she's going to be with us talking about building your brand. Keith Battle will be there doing a little comedy. Hey, Dr. C. Guy Robinson is an author. He is an adjunct professor at Morgan State University. He's the pastor of the Tabernacle of the Lord in Baltimore. He's going to be talking about mental health and emotional stability as a leader. Glenn Ogilvy is a respected community leader in our community. He is the CEO for the Center for Nonprofit Management, and he's going to be discussing partnerships. What is that called, Dr. Maddie? Cross what? Cross-sector partnerships. Amen. Thank you for saving me on that one. And so we've got a plethora of leaders coming in that we believe are the best practitioners in their fields of leadership. So please hit that QR code, register, make sure you hold your spot, and hold a spot for the people you want to pour into, the leaders who you lead with. It's going to make a difference in their life, all right? All right, can we go? Are y'all ready for the word? All right, let's go. I'm starting a new series today. It's a four-part series called God's Family. Everybody say God's Family. Yeah, that's what we are. And to get us ready musically, we are Zion Music, going to take y'all back to 1979, before most of them were born. Let me see if y'all know this one. Thank you. Yeah, y'all remember that one? Yeah, Capitol Center, 1979, the back to school boogie. Amen. All right, we are family. Dysfunctions or not, if you got a seat near you and people, we good? Please, we good. Okay, don't say that. Say it. All right, well, open the door. I don't know what to say. If you got a seat near you, can you raise your hand so that people can come in and slide in like they wasn't late? I don't want no trouble. I don't want no problems. But we are family. We're family whether we come from different backgrounds and we have different experiences, but we're family. We fuss and fight, but we're still family. Amen. And what this series is all about is finding out what God expects of us as his family, what he expects of us in our devotion to him, how he expects us to operate in church, how he expects us, what kind of etiquette we're supposed to have, how do we respect and interact with church leaders, how do we handle pneumatic matters in scripture, all of that. And what I'm going to do over these 4 weeks is focus on 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. So if you have a Bible or access to the Bible, join me in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and there we will focus in on that section of the Word of God. And if you are at Zion Woodbridge or Zion Fort Washington or Landover or Greenbelt, and you are physically able to stand with me before I read these verses without harm to yourself, please join me in standing now as we reverence God's Word, as we read His Word together. And hey, if you're online, you're on YouTube Live, Facebook Live, Roku, Apple TV, church website, Black Planet, MySpace, wherever you at, you done tuned in, you done found a way. Amen. You can stand up too. Just stand up in your dorm room. Stand up at home. Feel like we're all together. I'm going to read just 5 verses. I'm going to read verse 11. I'm going to read part of verse 13. I'm going to read verses 14 and 15 and verse 26 as we focus on this section today around interpersonal relationships in the family of God. Yeah. Verse 11 says this. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Verse 13, I just want to focus on the end of verse 13 that says, live in peace with each other. Verse 14, we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Verse 15, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Verse 26, greet all God's people with a holy kiss. All right, my single people, that's your opportunity. If you just you're feeling some kind of way, you say, the pastor said, there you go. Make your move. I'm just joking. Let's pray. Father, speak to us now. Your servants are listening. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Before I give you my subject, let me look at this one more time. I want to go back to verse 11, and I want you to pay attention to language that are repetitive in this passage. First of all, it says, therefore, encourage one another. Everybody say one another. And then it says, build each other up. Everybody say each other. Go to verse 13, the end of verse 13. It says, live in peace with who? Everybody say each other. Yeah, verse 14, the end of verse 14 says, be patient with everyone. It says at top of verse 14, we urge you, brothers and sisters. Then in verse 15, it says again, it says, do what is good for each other. It is clear that the Apostle Paul is trying to teach the Thessalonican church, the church of Thessalonica, that we're in this together. It's about each other. There shouldn't be cliques and sexed and separation, which we typically do, but we're in this together. And so my subject today is love each other. Love each other. Love each other. Say that with me. Love each other. Again, love. Woodbridge, love each other. Landover, love each other. Fort Washington, love each other. Zion everywhere, love each other. Right here at Greenbelt, love That's our calling. It doesn't say like each other. That's preference based. Love is from God. And God loves everyone. So love each other. At a time in our world where people are losing their life senselessly to gun violence, we need to love each other. When you don't know how much time you have left with those who you love, it is imperative that we take every moment we can to love each other. Because you never know what somebody has on them and what they're carrying and what they're, the load that they're up under. We have to make sure that we're taking time to love each other. We are so focused on ourselves that sometimes we don't even know who it is. We don't even know who we sat beside in church. And I'm trying to waken us. We need a love wake-up call because our world is full of anger and hate, but God is calling his family to love each other. Let me start like this. If you live alone, it's a nice outfit, man. If you live alone, there are some benefits to living by yourself. Somebody said, they just got divorced. Amen. It's definitely a benefit. Yeah, definitely. If you live alone, you don't have to, you can roll the toilet paper up or down. And what? If you live at home and work from home, you don't even have, you can be funky. What difference do it make? Who gonna smell you? You don't have to look right when nobody, you don't have to worry about how you look, what you have on. You can press the toothpaste from the middle, the bottom, the top. What? This is the one I like. You can set the temperature where you want the temperature to be. And there is a, listen, now living alone can be lonely sometimes, but it's peaceful. It ain't no tension. Now, if you live alone and there's arguing going on in your house, we do have therapists available today. We work with everything here. We can get you some help. But for the most part, living alone is peaceful. But the moment you bring one person into your home, the whole game changes. I don't care how much you love them or like them. It could be your friend, your BFF. It could be your family member. When they come in that house, they break your rhythm. How many people know? You can't really say it because you're sitting next to them. But I'm just saying, we got to have some signals where y'all can let me know you're following me. But I don't want you to get in no trouble. But I'm telling you, it's just a matter of time before you start saying, I don't even know if I should have did this. They're going to do something to get on your nerves. They're going to say something to get on your nerves. They're going to leave something undone. It just ain't the way I like it. You don't even know how it's meant. Ain't the way I like it. How many of you know I'm telling the truth? It's just something about if you add somebody into, I don't care if y'all soulmates. Y'all could have met at the Frankie Beverly concert. It don't make no difference. It's just a matter of time before they will get on your nerves. And then that's just one person. Imagine if they brought people with them. Let's say you had two or three people. You know a family, they just going through something. So you say, well, just come on over here. It's all well and good when the Lord laid that on your heart. But when you realize what this means, you be counting the days. Like we said 2 weeks, didn't we? What day is this? Now, this is not apples and apples. It doesn't mean you don't love the people. It's just coexisting is hard. Being around people creates an environment that creates tension. Now, multiply that, two or three people in your house giving you drama, and multiply that by 100 and come into a church, and you got a whole nother set of drama. Not just two or 300 people or 2,000 or 3,000 people, because even though we don't live together, we are around each other enough to mess each other's nerves up. That's a fact. And when you live with somebody you don't like, you can just lock your bedroom door and they can't. That's a sign. It's locked for a reason. I'm in here for a reason. You avoid them. You come home late. You try to wait. You can do that. You can't do that at church because you ain't got no door in here. What door are you going to close? Where are you going to go? So the way we do it, this is the way we close the door in church. We don't speak to each other. Anybody we don't get along with, that's a sign we don't speak. I'm just here to do my job. I'm just here to worship the Lord. I came for the word. I ain't here, I ain't studying you, I don't mess with you like that. And God says, but God's call to us is to do what? Love each. Oh, this is gonna be the right series. I know this is the right series for us. Because let me tell you something, it is impossible to work with people, volunteer with people, serve with people, worship with people, and somebody not mess with your nerves. Somebody not rub you the wrong way. And some relationships get off to the wrong start because people talk about each other. Like we don't even go to the person who've offended us. We start off on the wrong foot because we tell people about the person that offended us, which is actually sin. It's called gossip. So what I want to do today is I want to start in verse 11, and really there are 11 things, and I'm going to go through them quickly, that Paul tells the church of Thessalonica directly. We're being told indirectly, here are the things we can do to help us to love each other. And the first one is in verse 11. In fact, there's two of them in verse 11. It says, first of all, encourage one another. And then it says, build each other up. So that's one and two. Encourage one another, build each other up. Now, those two words seem the same, Dad, but they're actually opposites. To encourage somebody actually is a word of comfort. It means to hold somebody up. It means to undergird them in difficult times. To build somebody up is not a comforting word, it's actually a correction word. Building is about construction. What Paul does here, he pictures people as if they are buildings and says, whenever you're going in to do some building work, it's messy. It is sawdust, it's construction, it's knocking down walls, it's renovation, it's adding floors. That's the kind of thing. So here's what God says. Both, all of it's love, but in one hand, you're holding somebody up, and the other hand, you're building somebody up, which means discipleship and mentoring, and most people don't like to be built up because you got to correct them. We don't mind comfort, but we take offense to correction, but all of it is love. Ooh, I lost this congregation already. How did I lose y'all so fast? Any family that only has comfort and no correction is a family that's dysfunctional. If you only comfort the people in your family and never correct, we have no maturity. But if it's all correction and no comfort, now we have disconnection. Oh, there it is. All correction is disconnection. Bars. Got you. Whenever you have a parent, and that's all they do, correct, straighten out, correct, straighten. That's why when you come in the house, everybody leave. But here's what God says, both of them are necessary. In fact, give me Romans 14:9, I think it is. Romans 14:19, here's what Paul says there. He says, so then let us aim for harmony in the church. Watch this, we're trying to be harmonious, but he says, and try to build each other up. He understood. He says, these two things are hard to do together. I'm trying to be harmonious, but he says, can we keep harmony while trying to build people up? While dealing with something people don't like? Because as soon as you go from holding a person up to trying to build them up, now they start hearing from God. This is when they start hearing from God, Buffy, and saying, the Lord told me my season is up here. Whenever you start trying to go, that's why people who have church hurt, a lot of people who have church hurt are not people who just been wounded, it's people who refuse to be corrected. Ooh, this is gonna be a tough crowd. I'm all right, I'm built for it. So whenever people start correcting you, you start hearing, you know what, it ain't no big deal, just God spoke to me and said, follow the cloud. And so I'm moving on. And I'm saying, you move on because every time somebody tries to correct, so you're a victim everywhere you go. Not just churches, relationships, basketball team, football program. You can't stay anywhere. And everywhere else you go, you're an expert on what happened to you, but you're not an expert on what's wrong with you. Because nobody can ever tell you what's wrong with you. Because you are always the victim. It is always somebody else's fault. And then you go to the next place, you go to the next tribe, you go to the next team, you go to the next relationship, you go to the next church, and you always inform them, this is what I don't play. This is why I had to leave that church. That's why I had to leave that program. That's why I had to leave that ministry. That's why I had to leave that team, because they're toxic. It's never about you. It's always they are toxic. When they weren't toxic, they were just trying to hold you accountable. Ooh, it must be for y'all, because y'all are man. Did you say something to him about me? What you doing? Like, This is the reality of the world we live in. And so Paul says, I don't want you just comforting people. You got to correct them. That's love. You see, because what we do is we see people that need correction, but we don't say anything to them. We say, ain't she wild? To somebody else. Ain't he a trip? Well, that's just as wrong as whatever they're doing. Because how will that help them? It just kind of impacts and influences people's opinion about them. So here's the challenge. We got to be willing to comfort and correct. Let me go to verse 13. The third thing he says is live at peace with each other. Now, if the Bible says, Pastor Milton, if Paul says, I want you to live at peace with each other, that means if it's a directive, if it was just a, you know, like a, an affirmation, that's different. But because it's a directive, that's a clear sign that it's not natural. It is not natural. People in peace do not go naturally together. It's hard to coexist with people. It's hard to coexist with people you work with. The more time you spend with them, the more opportunities for conflict and tension and disagreement. So he says, live with peace with each other. Do whatever you got. Here's what, give me Romans 12, 18. Romans 12, 18. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Here's our, we don't do that. As soon as somebody crosses the line, we block them, unfriend them, cancel them. I'm done with you. I don't mess with you no more. One offense. Oh, you ain't showing me who you are. And I'm saying, even if they're wrong, have you done everything you can to live at peace? We are done with people just like that. And here's what, now I'm not saying that they're not some toxic situations that you need to get out of. I'm not saying that you haven't been victimized or you haven't been harmed. But every time, everybody's wrong. Every situation, there is no culpability on your part in any part, in any relationship. You have always been the only one right in the situation. That is absolutely ridiculous. And there's something in you that knows it, but you cannot humble yourself to admit it. So I'm going to show you a tool right now of how we can live at peace with each other and love each other. What? Love. This tool I learned from Pastor Jenkins at First Baptist Glen Arden. He's my pastor, and he calls it an SBI. And an SBI is what you present to somebody when they've offended you. So you come to the person, and first of all, you tell them the situation. And then you tell them what their behavior was, what did they say or do in that situation. And then you tell them the impact that their behavior in that situation had on you. That's an SBI. You go to a person, when you've been hurt by somebody, your responsibility is not to tell everybody else what they did. We tend to lean into relationships that see things our way. But we don't deal with the person that caused us the pain. You don't go do an SBI while you're still hurt, while you're still upset, while you're still angry. You do it when you calm down enough and you bring this to the attention. Say, here's the situation. It was 2 weeks ago or it was last Thursday or whatever. When we were out in the parking lot, you said something that was very hurtful and you said it in front of other people. And the impact, it was embarrassing to me that you would say that. And I just wanted to bring it to your attention because I want our relationship to be whole. That's how you bring it to a person. You do not say what their intent was. I does not stand for intent. You can't say to the person, well, I knew you was trying to hurt me the whole time. Now you being a witch. That's witchcraft. You can't tell somebody what their motive was. You say, this is the situation. This is what you said or did. This is how it made me feel. That's impact. Are you with me? The person is supposed to respond with, this is my thing. I wrote a book about this, shameless plug, L-U-V-A-F-A. They're supposed to start by just listening. Don't listen defensively. Listen to understand. Dr. Doug White says, you understand people when you humble yourself and stand under them. Like, I humble myself. Please show me what you, let me see if I, and you can prove that you understood what you heard by putting it into your own words. Let me see if I understand what you said. That shows a person that you care instead of responding. And the third thing you want to do is validate what they've said. Because even if they were off, you should be able to put yourself in their shoes and say, I can see how you would have felt that way about what I said in the parking lot. That actually makes sense. Even if they misread what you did, your job is not to put them in their place. Your job is to put yourself in their place. What we try to do is we get all defensive and say, how you gonna think that about me? You should know me by now. I ain't even that kind of person. This ain't even about you. This is about a hurt person coming to you that you hurt. How do you get to make a person feel bad about being hurt by you? And how do you get to say, that shouldn't even bother you? You don't get to tell people what hurts them or not. Then after you have validated them, then you apologize. You know what? I can see how that works, and I am so sorry for the pain I caused you. Now, this is Pastor Jenkins. We worked on this together. He says you should, at this point, this is his entry, ask people to forgive you. Forgiveness. I don't know how he had the right to put his stuff in my stuff, but I'm just saying he's my pastor. So you should ask for forgiveness. Now, the reason why I put that, I have caution about this is because you don't want to force somebody to forgive you and say, would you please forgive me? Because they need time to process whether or not your apology is sincere. And they need this, which is maybe the most important part of the Luvafa, which is an amendment. What are you going to do differently so that I can feel safe around you? Because, see, one, I need you to apologize because that means you take ownership. But it's much more important to me that you change your behavior so that I can feel safe again. Because have you ever had somebody apologize to you and they apologize to you, but they keep doing the same thing? I'd rather you just say, I'm going to change my behavior. You ain't even got to be sorry. I just don't want to live in this kind of danger anymore, because whatever you've done, you showed me what you're capable of repeating. Are y'all tracking with me? In fact, a real apology, I learned this from Pastor Jeff Simmons years ago, a true apology should happen at the level that the offense took place. What do I mean by that? That means I don't just apologize to you what I said in the parking lot. I bring everybody back around that was in the parking lot that heard what I said and say to them, I offended her when I said that. I offended him when I said that. And you all heard it. I already apologized to this person privately, but I want to apologize to you all because y'all saw it and that wasn't right and I want to own it in front. That's the next level right there. That's how God's family supposed to operate. Don't embarrass me in public, then try to make right with me in private, and then we show up in public like nothing happened. Own it where you did it. Own it where you did it. I just made that up. Own it where you did it. That's how God's family rolls. Let's go to verse 14. Are y'all getting anything? The goal is to love each other. What? It ain't gonna be easy. In verse 14, he gives three groups that he says, I need you to love. And you're gonna love, some of the love's gonna be tough. First of all, he says, to the brothers and sisters in the church. This is not, we're gonna talk about leadership next week. This ain't for the leaders. This is not for the elders. He says, this is for the Adelphoi. The brothers and sisters in the church, this is what I'm urging y'all to do. Warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened and help the weak. And then he says, and then be patient with everybody. That's a lot of work right there. But let's talk about these three groups he says we need to address. He says, first of all, warn those that are idle and disruptive. He's good ready to say encourage the disheartened and help the weak. But look at the balance again. There it is again. Correction and compassion, right? It's not comfort and correction. All of that is love. Yeah. What makes you think because somebody checks you that they don't love you? We are so adverse to correction that we treat all of it like it's hatred. Let me tell you something. I wouldn't waste time to correct you if I didn't love you. I'm going to tell you that right now. I don't have time to correct people. I just get rid of you. If I'm sitting down trying to correct you, that's love. We don't see it that way for whatever reason. But he says, first of all, I want you to warn some people. They're idle and disruptive. Now, the reason why the NIV puts two words there is because there's debate upon what that Greek word means. Most new translations use the word idle, because in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, the same Greek word is used, and it comes up before it says people don't work. It says warn people who don't have jobs, and they're unemployed. So that's why most people believe that's the word, that's what the word means. But actually, the word is actually disruptive. It's a Greek word that means to be without arrangement. It's chaos. It is somebody who is out of order, We now call it out of pocket. And the Bible says you're supposed to confront people out of pocket. That wasn't right what you said. That wasn't right what you did. I come to you in love. Because I don't have the right to talk about you if I'm not going to talk to you.
Come on.
Because we'll say to everybody, you see how out of pocket she is? Yeah, out of pocket he is? If it was really an offense, why are you telling everybody else and getting them all upset? Come to the person. Tell them the offense. You may have misunderstood it. You may have misread it. But then, see, this is the thing. You can believe something about a person that's not true, and all of their actions and behavior will reinforce the lie that you believe. Because you never even checked in to see if that was really what was driving their behavior. And then you're checking their intent. I know why he did that. I know why she said that. Never did like me. Ain't nobody even studying you that hard. I remember somebody in our church one time told me, this is a true story, and I love him because we've talked through this. He says, man, I can't believe that y'all sat there and watched us go through that divorce and didn't do nothing. I said, y'all divorced? I said, man, I didn't even know. He thought everybody in the church knew he was going through a divorce. I said, let me assure you of this. The people that come to Zion, they got so much of their own stuff, they ain't even watching your little marriage. Like, they don't even know you was even married. Everything we was doing in church, he was assuming, this them, they just letting us fall through the cracks. I ain't even know what was going on. Don't assume, go to the person. Warn those. Second thing he says, don't just warn those people who are disruptive, encourage the disheartened. This is a tough one, because a person who's disheartened means they are bereft of faith in God. They are despondent. And if you've never been that, be grateful, because life can hit you so hard. I've seen people get hit so hard with such grave tragedy that they didn't just walk away from church, they walked away from the faith. How could a loving God let something this bad happen in my life? It's real. And what church people try to do in that moment, we want to give somebody a word. What people need a shoulder. They don't need a sermon at that time. Sometimes they just need you to be, especially if you cannot identify with what they're going through. You have no point of reference for what it's like to be in this. Shut your mouth. Just be present. Just be a shoulder. Now, this is my personal opinion of the trauma that's taking people away from God. See, I believe there's so much evil in the world. It's just some things we just ain't gonna be able to avoid. It's just that the world is that evil. And then when it doesn't make sense to me theologically, when my little theology doesn't line up with the tragedies and traumas of life, when I don't have a scripture for it, when I can't make it make sense, I have two things that Dr. Walter Scott Thomas says he has in his battery pack. These are the two things that keep me going. I don't care how bad it gets. I really believe this, that in Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. I just believe somehow the worst situation has got some good that's gonna come out of it somehow. I hold on to that. Even when it looks terrible, I just hold on. Something good has gotta come out of this. The second thing I hold on to is a hymn that I learned as a child in the church. And it goes like this, it says, by and by, when the morning comes, when all the saints of God are gathered at home, we will tell the story of how we overcome. And we may not understand it now. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But we'll understand it better by and by. I didn't ever understand that when I was younger, but the saints were saying, there's some things in this life we're not going to understand, but one day we'll understand it better by and by. In fact, I don't even think when we get to heaven, we're going to have a lot of questions. I think we're going to be so grateful that we got there. But if we need understanding, we may not get it in this life. And that's why 1 Thessalonians 4:13, all the way through chapter 5, verse 10, Paul is trying to tell them about eternity. He says, we're going to one day get raptured. And he's talking about eschatology. And he's trying to put eternity in perspective. Because you can get through life if you can see past life.
Wow.
If you can see to eternity that one day this will all make sense, it can help you get through life. If in this life all you have is hope in this life, we are of all men most miserable. But I understand that some glad morning when this life is over, I'm going to fly away. And to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. It just doesn't end. If it ends with this, this is not good. You got to have a hope beyond this time. Are you listening to me? The third thing he says is help the weak. Our goal is what? To love. To do what? He says help the weak. That word weak means to be strengthless. It is a person who is physically or socially without power. Either they have some kind of medical situation or they're fighting some kind of injustice that has disabled them. And in that moment, here's what the Bible says, the strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. They are weak and they need our strength. And that's part of loving each other. Let me hurry up and get through the last few. Verse 15 says, here's the next thing we do if we're going to love each other. In verse 15, don't exchange wrong for wrong. Don't pay people back wrong for wrong. Because the old saying says, two wrongs don't make a right. He says, what I love about this is, he doesn't even say don't do people wrong off the break. He says, don't get people back when they did you wrong. Because most of us wouldn't do somebody wrong, but we feel righteous and vindicated if they started. If they started, I'm gonna finish it. He says, don't finish it, flip it. Ooh. Just because they went low, don't mean you're supposed to go low. Pastor Jeff says, our response is our responsibility. God says, I want you to do right. I know this ain't street code. This is God's family code. That's why a lot of violence happens, because people are retaliating over stuff that's not even worth it. And he says, don't return wrong for wrong. Love each other. Sometimes, y'all, you just got to walk away. Sometimes you just got to scroll away, because somebody can be on your page acting up. And everything in you wants to be responsive. But here's the thing. You got to sometimes ignore ignorance. Most of the people that attack me on my page, they have fake pages, or they don't private page. They only have a picture, but they're coming at me. You got to ignore ignorance, because you turn ignorance into brilliance when you respond to it. Wow. Ooh, that was good right there. So you turn ignorance into brilliance. Now you look smart if I respond. Then sometimes you got to let hurt people. You got to understand that hurt people hurt people. Some people are lashing out at you because of their own pain. I was in physical therapy this past week, and one of the things the physical therapy team was telling me, he said, when we do the work we do, you have to be able to bob and weave, because people will swing at you. And I said, what do you mean? He says, sometimes what we do to people puts them in so much pain, the reflex is they hit us. It's a reflex, y'all. Anybody that goes off on you like that, just snap like that on you, that ain't your problem. That's their pain. Let me back up. I ain't trying to go in that with you. Because he says, what's the next thing he says? He said, don't just pay back people wrong for wrong. What do you do? Strive. It's going to be hard. Strive to do good for others, for each other. And the next one is strive to do good for everyone else. So you strive to do good for people inside the church family and people outside the church family, because everybody's watching us. They're watching church people. That's an excuse. That's why I don't go to church. They hypocrites. They act just like us, all that. And now people are watching. You ever seen a baseball game? They call it a bean ball. That's what they used to call it. If a pitcher tries to intentionally hit you with a baseball, that's a tough predicament to be in. But when it happens, in that moment, the batter is in control of the whole environment. Why do I say that? If the batter puts his bat down and walks to first base, because he is allowed to go to first base, he's been hit with a pitch, nothing happens. If the batter throws his helmet down and runs to the mound, the dugout, the bullpen, everything empties, is a brawl. Sometimes you need to respond the right way, because everybody's going to follow your move. Now you got your cousins involved, your colleagues, everybody fighting. Now somebody gonna get shot, stabbed, black dyed up, you know, because you wanted to say who you were. When walking away gives us another day to live and an opportunity to reconcile something that wasn't even worth how far it escalated. Let me go to this last thing. We're trying to do what? Yeah, okay. This is a tough crowd. Love each other. Love each other. Say it.
Love each other.
Here's the last way, verse 26. Greet all God's people with a holy kiss. Now, when you study the Bible, you got to study it contextually, because when it's a Pauline epistle where Paul's writing a letter to a church, you got to understand, is this something that was meant for a particular group of people in a particular period of time, or is this a perpetual teaching that is timeless and fits any culture and context? What we do know is that in Greco-Roman culture and Greek culture and Jewish culture, that people did kiss each other when they greeted each other, even cross-gender or even same gender, and they would do that, and some customs still do that. But the kiss is usually on the forehead, on the cheek, or both cheeks, or even on the hand. That's not our culture. What we do is hug. That's how we greet each other. In fact, come here, Pastor Milton. In fact, this is the standard bro hug right here. We do it, you see it everywhere. I don't know who started, but this is what we're gonna do. Right here and right here, that's what we do. It ain't nothing no real affectionate about it. It's just saying, we good. We go here and we good. Sometimes we hold this, you know what I'm saying? Right here, that's the bro hug. Now, I've never seen a lady do that. I never watch y'all do that with each other. I don't pay attention, but I don't think y'all do that. Y'all got your own hugs, so I don't know how to do a lady hug. But now, when we hug ladies in church, we try to be careful, because you know, there's a lot of perversion out here and a lot of sensuality, and you got to have your boundaries. So you know, the ladies, we kind of go like this when we're hugging the sister. Like, hey, 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 praise the Lord. It's like, praise the Lord. Hey, praise the Lord. How you know? How the family? This is kind of safe. Now, my mentor told me that you're actually really supposed to hug and your heart's supposed to connect. It's heart to heart. That's really an expression of true love and that we're good. The whole idea, y'all, look at the verse. It says, greet each other. The greeting, here's the point when you're loving each other, your greeting should communicate safety.
Yes.
This greeting says, we're good. But the reason, but it's holy. That's not just purity, that's sincerity. Don't hug me if we're not good. Because Judas kissed Jesus and it wasn't holy. So if we cannot embrace, that's communicating we need to have a talk. Who are y'all getting this? The goal is to create, and even if you're not a hugger, I don't want to do that. Let's do it this way. Everybody has somebody you see regularly, but you don't hug. How many would agree with that? There's some people you see all the time, but you don't hug them. All right, watch this. Watch this. Would it change if they were in verse 14? That wasn't even a joke. You all right over there? You live alone, too. You do that at home, don't you? It's just anytime. You watching TikTok right now. You just saw something funny, and there you go. Amen. Now I gotta remember what I was saying. So if you don't hug people, you know some people you don't hug. I want you to get somebody in your mind that you don't typically hug. Now watch this. Now go back to verse 14. Remember those two groups? One is people who are disheartened, despondent. They're so bereft at the tragedy they have experienced that even trusting God is hard. Wow. Or maybe they're standing over a casket and grieving, and you see them in that moment, are you more apt to hug them then? You see how you move differently when they're shattered? Or if they're feeble and they're weak and they're in a medical condition and they look at you with tears. And I'm saying, if we're more apt to hug them in that situation, why do people have to be shattered for us to show them love? It's like, if they good, we good. Hey, you good? All right, you good. Well, you broken down and you and ready to give up. Now we're hugging you. And here's what Paul's saying. You don't wait till that happens. We need an environment where our greetings say we good. Whether you're in my frat or you're in my sorority or you in my neighborhood or whatever, you guess what we're related to? We're blood relatives. Ooh, you'll get that on the way home. There's one blood that dripped off Calvary's cross that has washed all our sins away. We all blood relatives in the family of God. I got to pray because we're over time. Father, thank you for your word. Your word tells us to love each other just as you have loved us. You are not only the epitome of love, you empower us to love. So help us to love like you want us to love. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn the service over now to the campus pastor and host on your campus.
Thank you, Lord.
Love each other.
Love each other.
Love. It's such a simple phrase.
It is.
Very powerful
yes.
phrase.
I love you, Pastor Joy.
I love you too, yes. Larry. Yes. I love you. You know, I don't know about you, but I feel like the phrase "I love you" is something that we honestly don't say enough mm-hmm. to each other in a pure sense, right?
Yes. Yes.
Oftentimes, if you're watching a movie or a TV show, "I love you" is between a couple.
Yes.
But to hear it between just two people in the body of Christ saying "I love you,"
I love you,
it's something that we really should do more because yeah. Jesus is all about love,
yes.
right?
Yes.
The whole resurrection is about God's love for us and what he did so that we can be united with him forever.
Yeah.
So I just want to encourage you that if you want to learn more about the love of Christ, if you want to learn why we are excited about God's love, why we want to encourage you to share God's love, please text ZAVIP to 51555. Again, ZAVIP to 51555. We'd be happy to connect with you, share more about God's love with you, how God's love can change you from the inside out. From this message, Larry, what's one of your takeaways?
One of my takeaways is patience. As we are leaning into showing love and showing each other love and loving each other, we really have to exercise patience to make sure that we are truly leaning in to authentically show up and say, you know what, I do love you, so that we can be real in that kind of communication. So really, patience and building the love is what I'm taking away from today's lesson. How about you?
I like it. I think one of the things that he said today is that in the beginning when he said about encourage and build each other up, mm-hmm. you need that comfort, but you need that correction because that builds connection.
Yeah. Yeah.
We want to hear from you. What is your takeaway? But more importantly, what is one thing you can do this week to love somebody? This whole message today was about love each other. And as he went through the scripture, past the battle, highlighted some ways that we can love each other by encouraging, building each other up, doing good to each other, forgiving one another, being patient with one another, strengthening each other. What is one thing you can do this week to show love to someone? Let us know in chat.
While you're putting your answers in the chat, we have a few reminders to share with you. We have pastries with the pastors coming up April 13th. The first five attendees will receive a very special treat for pastries with the pastors. Visit znch.org/pastries.
Yes.
Now, pastries are pastries, right?
It's pastries.
Don't come expecting the bacon, egg, and cheese.
No. This is just a light breakfast continental bagel and coffee kind of vibe with the Z18.
Okay. And if you hosted a gathering today, we want to know that you hosted the gathering. So please email us at the email address that is on your screen or text ZA Gather to 51555. That's what's on your screen.
Yeah, remember, we encourage you all to host a gathering because Easter is a great day for people to come to church. So if you hosted a gathering, take a picture, do a nice little ussy with your group, and send us one at anywhere at zionchurch.org. Hey, one more thing before we head over to Pastor Jackie, who is here live with us at Greenbelt. Hey, ladies, want to remind you to join us for the Build Her Women's Retreat happening April 19th to the 21st in Norfolk, Virginia. Again, that's April 19th to the 21st in Norfolk, Virginia. We're going to be hosting Build Her. And parents, don't forget, XK in the Kitchen is happening also this month. Go to znch.org/XK in the Kitchen to learn more. Hey, Pastor Jackie, what's going on over there?
Thanks, Pastor Joy. Hi, everyone. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We are here with Gigi and Danny. Gigi, so can you tell us, how will you love someone this week?
I think I'll love someone this week and really just love each other, love everyone that I encounter by being gracious, expressing my feelings. You know, I love you. I appreciate you. I'm thankful for you. Sometimes we don't always do that. And I think by expressing my feelings and being gracious is how I'll show love this week.
I love that. Expressing her feelings and being gracious. Okay, Danny, so how will you show love to someone this week?
Good. I'll probably take from what Pastor Battle said, build up and encourage. So build up, I will be more conscious about correcting and having understanding and compassion, as well as encouraging, using encouraging words, and honestly, truly loving from the heart. So
I love that. Build up and encourage. Y'all hear that? Loving from the heart. Thank you, Gigi and Danny. So y'all, we love you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Please remember to join us next Sunday, 10 minutes before service, for our pre-service experience. For now, check out our InFocus announcements and have a great week.
Hey, Zion Church. Welcome to this week's InFocus announcements. Come learn about Zion Church at our prospective member class Under the Hood. The class is offered every first and third Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time via Google Meet. The next class is coming up this Wednesday. Visit znch.org/UTH to learn more and register.
The 2023 Year in Review magazine is now available. 2023 was a year forward for Zion Church. Take a look inside to see the work and exponential impact that was possible with your support. Visit znch.org/magazine23 or scan the QR code on the screen to view.
Calling all married couples, spouses are invited to join the Solid Marriage Ministry for an interactive conversation about communication in marriage. Join us virtually on Thursday, April 11th at 7 p.m. Together, we will discuss how to actively listen, speak honestly, navigate challenges, embrace empathy, and so much more. Text SOLID to 51555 to register or visit the link on the screen for more details.
To find out what's happening at Zion Church, visit zionchurch.org/events or scan the QR code on the screen.